I want to talk about Webpack and WebAssembly. So basically, we integrated Webpack and WebAssembly, and I want to talk about the challenges we had when implementing this. And at first, I want to give a short introduction into WebAssembly and ECMAScript modules. I hope everybody knows what WebAssembly is. Okay. And what ECMAScript modules are? Ah, okay, so we first start with WebAssembly. So WebAssembly is a low-level binary format for code, for native code, which is usable in the web. And the only types that are available are integer and float types. So no strings, no complex types, only basic, very basic types. So it's more a low-level format. You have also access to memory, so you can put strings into memory, but it's more complex, more involved than native types, string types in JavaScript. WebAssembly is usually compiled from a native language like C++, C, or Rust, or the other languages. But there's also a native textual representation of WebAssembly, which is called WET, WOT, whatever. And there's also the shortcut WASM for WebAssembly. So the structure of a WebAssembly file is built out of binary sections, so kind of blobs in the file. There are some important sections for this talk, which are highlighted here, but I quickly go over all of them. So basically, there's an import section, which it's kind of like import, if you write the import syntax in ECMAScript modules, so you describe dependencies of the module. There's a global section, which describes global variables in the WebAssembly module. There's a function types or types section, which describes the types of function used in the WebAssembly module. So kind of this function has three arguments, which are all 4-byte integers and one return value of an 8-byte integer. So kind of this. And there's a code section, which contains the actual code of every function. So a kind of assembly or bytecode instructions which are processed when executed. There's this data section, which describes some initial values for the memory. There's an export section, which is kind of important because it kind of exports functions or globals or memory from the module, so kind of the export syntax in ECMAScript modules. There's a start section, which says this code is executed on startup, when the module is instantiated. And there are also other sections, but we don't care about this. And there's also the possibility of do custom sections if somebody likes to do this. So here's an example of this textual format for WebAssembly. So it starts with the wrapping for the whole module. Then we declare some types. Here's a type for the app function, which is a function getting have one argument with an integer and one return value with an integer, and this other values. And there's this import section, which are kind of described with this syntax. So we're kind of importing the get value function from a module. We also have to specify which type it is. So it's a function and it's of this type. And you can also declare your own function. This is kind of the code section. So function add, which adds two numbers, one with calling another function, and local variables. So kind of this is the format of WebAssembly. So only basic features, there are more possibilities with memo section, other sections, but this is the stuff you need for this talk. So there's also an API for WebAssembly. So you can call WebAssembly modules from JavaScript. So it's kind of four steps. At first, you have to fetch the binary or get the binary. So in most cases, you fetch it with a fetch function in JavaScript, get some byte buffer. Then you compile the byte buffer or the blob into a WebAssembly module. And in the next step, you instantiate the module. So you can do multiple instances from one module. So you instantiate the module, and you get an instance. While instantiating, you have to pass this kind of imports object. So every import section has to have a matching property in the imports object. So you have to pass all imports while instantiating. And once instantiated, this instance has a property exports where all the exports are available. So if you have exported a function from module, then this will be a property in the exports object. So for step 2 and 3, there are synchronous and asynchronous variants. The asynchronous variants return promises and do the compilation or the instantiation in the background process in browser or outside of the main thread. And yeah, the sync variants just do sync. So MScript module, ECMAScript modules. So ECMAScript modules are kind of like a new source type for JavaScript codes. So every other non-ECMAScript module code is called script, so a script tag. And the new source type is called module. It has some implications like it's always strict, it has new syntax, and some other stuff. And the new syntax allowed is kind of import and export. You may also know this, but here's a short summary of exporting and importing. Just the basics, if you call, if you have the syntax export x and y, this actually does not create an object and does not export an object. It export bindings to the variables x and y in the scope, so you don't copy the values. It's kind of registering this variable is now accessible from other scope. So if you later do a import x and y from this module, it don't copy the values. It binds to the original scope and have this live connection. So it doesn't deviate. You have no new memory space where the value is stored. You just reference the old memory space and have read-only access to the values x and y in the other scope. Okay, there's also a life cycle for ECMAScript modules, which is kind of important. So three phases. The first phase is to load, so download and pass all the files and all the modules, and to resolve all imports. So it basically resolve if you have some kind of identifier URL in the imports, and it resolve it, downloads the file, and recursively downloads and resolves and passes all files in the whole graph. So once all files are passed and processed in the first phase, then the second phase begins, which connects all the imports with the exports. So it basically puts this variable from the other scope into the scope of the importing module. And it's kind of the binding or kind of connecting, if you want to call this. And the second, the last phase is to evaluate all the code. So all code is evaluated, all at once and all in the same microtick, if you be exactly. And it's also the way that dependencies are evaluated in before the parent module is evaluated, except some exceptions. Okay. So the next step was we want to add WebAssembly support to Webpack. How do we do this? We started with a prototype and tried to implement some ideas and find problems with this and then iterate on that until we find all our goals completed. So we also got a sponsorship for this. Mozilla just gave us some money, sold some money at us and wanting us to implement WebAssembly. Seems like they want to push WebAssembly at all in general and also their own language. They're kind of good for WebAssembly, Rust forward, and that's great. So we started to define some goals. We wanted to have it easy to use because Webpack is already difficult to use, so we want to make this easy. And we also want to hide all technical details, all the asynchronous promises stuff. We want to hide this and just want to allow you to write, import, export for WebAssembly. We also don't want to care about what is the compiled to WebAssembly language you're going to use. So if it's C++, Rust, don't want to care. We only want to care it's WebAssembly and this spec. So other goal was to make it performant. So it should be not. We don't want to introduce any artificial limitations in performance. So you should not be forced to use the native API. We want to make this as performance as a native API. So Webpack thinks of modules, of files like modules. So everything in Webpack in the graph is a module. So we want to keep this and make WebAssembly also a module next to JavaScript, next to CSS, next to files, next to all the other modules in Webpack. And also, we want to have a good integration with ECMAScript modules. So basically, you should be able to import WebAssembly from ECMAScript, ECMAScript from WebAssembly, so they should work nicely together. And because one major feature of Webpack is code splitting, we also want to have code splitting support for WebAssembly, so you should be able to load some kind of bigger native module on demand or when needed. So yeah, the goals in JavaScript, in syntax or in code is like this. We want to make it able to use modules like this, to use normal WASM modules, to use compiled WASM modules, and also to use to import from WASM to WASM or to ECMAScript modules. So the idea was to add the module to WASM as module type, run all async, run to hide this, so we run all async operations on split points. So split points are basically asynchronous, so we can move all asynchronous operations at this point and hide them from the user. So basically, you're doing an import, and when importing, all the modules in the part lazy loaded are as instantiated, evaluated, so the WebAssembly modules are possessed at this point. Yeah, as I said, this import and export should be threaded like ECMAScript in ECMAScript, so working the same way. Because ECMAScript enforces a single instance per module, we also want to enforce this for WebAssembly. So if you require or import a WebAssembly module, you get a single instance and like a singleton instance. And we want to run the start section of the WebAssembly module in the evaluate phase of ECMAScript. So just to remember the different phases here, with resolving, loading, parsing, resolving, connecting imports, and last phase is to evaluate all modules. So what was the current state? At this point, when we started, we had Webpack 3, and we only supported a single module type, so everything must be JavaScript, everything was compiled to JavaScript. So this was the first problem, and the second problem was we didn't allow any additional operations except chunk loading at the split point, so we need to refactor some stuff. And basically made a change plan. We did support for multiple module types. So JavaScript was a module type before, so we had separated this into JavaScript, WebAssembly, JSON also as module type, and we as plugin should be able to add other module types, like example, and plugin adds CSS as separate module type. We also want to add the ability to emit multiple assets. So in addition to JavaScript files, we want to emit WebAssembly files with the binary blobs for chunks, and also emit the runtime code to load this WebAssembly assets at runtime. So first problem, first challenge, was the ECMAScript spec and the WebAssembly API are a little bit incompatible with each other. So the first two phases are likely the same. So loading is like fetching in WebAssembly. Parsing is like compiling. But the third phase, binding imports and exports. The problem in the WebAssembly API is that you only get the exports after evaluating the module, which are kind of different in between ECMAScript module spec and WebAssembly API. So this was the first challenge. So what we trying to do is we needed a parser for WebAssembly, so to extract the import and export sections, and we threaded imports like dependencies for other modules, like import or require. And we, at the split point, we added runtime code to fetch and compile the WebAssembly modules, so the first two phases. And to make it work like ECMAScript, we do at the evaluation phase, we load the dependencies, create an imports object of the for the WebAssembly, one instantiate in sync version, and then set up the exports. So because we're running this in sync versions, it is possible to inject into the evaluate phase, because the evaluate phase has to be in the same microtik, has to be synchronous, so we also need to instantiate sync in this case to make it work. But no. So in code, this looks like this at split point. This is simplified, but we fetching the WebAssembly module from an URL, and then we compile this response with compile streaming, which returns a promise, and now we finally we have the WebAssembly module. And in the evaluation phase, we instantiate the module passing the imports object, which is the second parameter to instance, with all the dependencies. The webpack require function loads dependencies. Well, it's like a require, but internally. And then we export all the exports from the WebAssembly module. Yes, this kind of had some problems. It's kind of working, but in some cases it's not working because of two browsers. An example, Chrome throws an error if using the synchronous instantiate function, if the binary is bigger than 4 kilobytes. Yeah, it's not in the spec, but they doing is this, and so we can't do this. And the second reason, which more is that it's bigger, that Safari doesn't compile. In the compile step, it likes to compile in the instantiate step, because for technical reasons, they say. That's a bit problematic because we're running synchronous instantiate, so compiling this module synchronous is bad for bigger modules and blocks the main threads, and we try to have this goal for performance, so it would be bad. So we must use instantiate streaming, which basically does everything, the compilation and the instantiation at once and in asynchronous way, instead of compiling and synchronous instantiating. So the next challenge was to implement this, to use this asynchronous instantiate. But the problem was we need to move instantiate into the split point code to do it asynchronously. But this means that we're running instantiate of the module before any dependency could be evaluated or is even loaded. So this could be cause issues because of two reasons. The first is the start section would run at the split point or no longer in the evaluation phase, so it's not what we want. And or we can't construct the imports object because imports are because dependencies are not yet available at this point. So WebAssembly kind of snapshots or copies values when you're calling instantiate from the imports object. So this was a problem. And it took a bit until we had a solution for this, and the solution is a bit complex. The plan is to rewrite the WebAssembly binary. We just remove the start section, and instead we also remove all imported globals because they are not available at that point. And instead, we create a new function into the WebAssembly binary, which is called webpack ini, or doesn't care about the name. And this init function is called with all the dependencies, so all the globals are passed into this function, and it copies its arguments to the globals, so it lazily initializes the globals, and it also calls the old start function, which now we can run this webpack init or call this webpack init function in the evaluation phase, and it should work correctly. This works for globals, but for functions we need to use another approach because you can't set functions in WebAssembly. You have to pass it via the imports object. So in this case, we're not passing the actual function from the dependency, so we're passing a trampoline function, which is a kind of a function calling the other function. So the good thing about the trampoline function is it can be passed, but the function, the trampoline function, the function that's called by the trampoline function don't have to be available at this time when creating the trampoline function. So the trampoline function is passed to the imports object and later will call the later available function from the dependency. In code, it looks like this. This is the original WebAssembly module. In this case, we import some function from another module. We import a global from another function, and we run some start function. So everything of this here shown is problematic. So in this case, we do transpile it or do rewrite this to the following WebAssembly. The function is still imported. This is later used in the JavaScript portion of the thing to pass a trampoline function. But the global is rewritten. It's no longer imported, but it's instead is mutable. So we can modify it. By default, globals are not mutable, so it's a kind of constant. So now they are mutable. And the start function stays the same, but the start section below is removed. And instead, we export this webpack init function, which kind of get one parameter, which is the value of the magic number global. And it sets the global and also calls the start function, so kind of delays the elevation, delays the start and initialization phase. From the JavaScript point of view, it looks like this. At split point, we create, I used the wrong API in this section. It should be the asynchronous instantiate function. And we basically use asynchronous instantiate and pass an imports object and pass this trampoline function. So we create this trampoline function here, which is the function getting the weird parameter. And this trampoline function later calls the later available exported function from the dependency. So here the dependency is gets a number ID in Webpack, so 1, 2, 3. And the export something is used like you see, so in the something is imported from module. Okay. And at evaluation phase, we then call out one or evaluate all dependencies. So like here, we evaluate the module and the A export and also pass calling the Webpack init function and passing all values of all globals. So next challenge. This works great for globals and functions and for the start section, but it was a problem with memory and tables. So you can import and export memory from WebAssembly modules, and you can also import tables, which are like, you don't have to care what the tables are, but it's like memory. So it doesn't work for memory, because memory can't be passed as argument to a function. It can't be used with a trampoline function because it's not a function. So it must be provided in the instantiation phase. So we must provide it before the dependency is available. So how do we do it? At first, because JavaScript dependencies are not available at this point, and we can't evaluate them. We don't have access to memory exported from JavaScript, so we just forbid to use memory tables from JavaScript. And for WebAssembly to WebAssembly imports, so if one WebAssembly module exports in memory and another WebAssembly module imports the memory, we handle this case directly in the runtime code, because we have in the runtime code, both WebAssembly modules are instantiated, so we can just instantiate the first WebAssembly module with the export, and then pass the value from the export directly when instantiating the next WebAssembly module. So for performance reasons, we still in parallel compile both functions, but we sequentialize the instantiation of the modules. So it's kind of like we delay the instantiation for the module with dependencies. So this works in most cases, but there are some special edge cases where this doesn't work. In example, you can import a global from a module and then export the same global, and like re-exporting. And you can also import one global, and then in another global, you have some kind of initialization expression, which mostly takes static values or constants, but it also can also take, like, gets a value from another global. And this is the problem when the other global is imported, because the instantiation expression, like the last parameter to global, is evaluated on instantiate, and for imported globals, we have written them, and the value is not yet available at this time. So this kind of gets the wrong value, or gets the wrong, snapshots the value too early. So here are some examples of these cases in WebAssembly code. Here, the first thing is importing a global, plus limbus import, and then re-exporting the global. So we're exporting global 0, which all globals are indexed with some numeric IDs, but we can also give them names. This is problematic because it's not available at this point, and also this third case where a global is initialized with another global and then exported, or even if not exported, it's problematic. So what we have to do is to detect these special cases and move the init expression from dependencies, from globals, which are not yet available, to the webpack init function, where the globals they depend on are initialized. Then we could handle the third case in the last slide. So if a global is initialized with another global, and for re-exported globals, we handle the re-exporting in the runtime code. So basically, by parsing, we detect this case and re-export this variable in the JavaScript part of the code. So we don't go the way through the WebAssembly module. We just re-export the module from the dependency directly. So the next problem was WebAssembly has this cool, nice long integer type, which is a kind of 8 bytes big, and JavaScript doesn't have this type, so it can't handle it. And if you invoke any function or get any global with this type, there would be a runtime error. So we can't do trampoline functions because this would go through JavaScript and would cause a runtime error if the function contains any large integer, any 8-byte integer in the signature. So this was a problem, and we solve this the same way like we solve memory exporting. We connect WebAssemblies for memory directly. We also connect function exports from WebAssembly, because you can't use them in JavaScript. So it's obvious that it must be used in WebAssembly, another WebAssembly module. So we find these cases and directly connect these modules, these WebAssembly modules, and pass functions with large integer types directly between these types. So it has the same workflow like memory, parallel compilation, but sequential instantiation. In cases the user does something like importing a function with an long integer signature into JavaScript, then they would get an error while runtime. But we can detect these cases and basically make a warning while compiling, so they get an early error. So it seems to work. There are some limitations which are still unsolved, like you can't import memory or tables from JavaScript. You have this kind of sequentialized instantiation, which could be better for performance, better solved for performance. You have this trampoline function, which has an overhead because you go through JavaScript, but at least it works. So far, these limitations are not so problematic because all compiled to WebAssembly languages basically embed and only export the module and don't import a module from another dependency. And using multiple WebAssembly modules in a single chunk, which has some kind of transitive dependencies, are very rare currently. So it's a kind of limitation, but it kind of still works. So then there was a spec created for this whole WebAssembly ECMAScript integration. There wasn't a spec before, so we just implemented it the way we like to have. I think I'm the last speaker, so can infinitive time. It's fine. non-function in this spec, in the spec proposal, better non-function ECMAScript to WebAssembly imports are disallowed. So basically, our limitation now becomes a feature in the spec. So it's disallowed. And we can all the globals are disallowed to import globals from JavaScript. So we can remove all the special handling for globals with rewriting globals and initialization and so such stuff. And it turns out that we are mostly compatible with our implementation is mostly compatible with the spec. So some minor issues, but I think they're solvable. And sometimes we support more than the spec allows, so it's good for us. And the next step would be to achieve full compatibility with the spec, so kind of have this WebAssembly ECMAScript integration backed by a spec, and the spec proposal may be merged or released, so that developers are more comfortable with adopting WebAssembly in ECMAScript integration kind of features. So there were also some recent developments. So another spec proposal was merged into the WebAssembly spec. So now importing and exporting mutable globals is allowed, which wasn't before. So this was a kind of problem for us. So now we no longer have this problem because it's now allowed. And yeah, so we may, if you import and export mutable globals between modules, we may need to connect these modules directly, otherwise it wouldn't work. So we can use kind of the same workflow like memory or function with large integer signatures to connect these modules directly. And then we also implemented some optimizations for WebAssembly. Like in WebAssembly, there's a kind of strings which in the import section or the export section, which names the exports and names the module names. We can kind of mangle them, or so replace them with single char strings, which are shorter, so we save a few bytes for the WebAssembly module. We can also do tree shaking for WebAssembly modules. So if a JavaScript module only uses some exports of the WebAssembly module, we can remove the exports or the export section for these not used exports in the module and remove it from the binary. Then technically, if there would be a WebAssembly minimizer, we could this would detect this code as dev code and would remove it. So the WASM module would shrink, but there is no minimizer yet. But I hope this is something for the future. So the future, some ideas for the future are: it would be cool to have some transparent solution for fallback JS if WebAssembly is not supported, or the feature set you're using in your WebAssembly module is not supported by the browser. So currently, it's possible to provide fallback with a normal import or code-splitting syntax. If an import fails, because a WebAssembly module can't be initialized or can't be loaded, then you can import another module as fallback. But it's kind of manual, and I kind of like if there's some fallback transparent solution for this. Maybe it's kind of .wasm.js file, which is used if the wasm failed loading. There's also this spec proposal about threads or workers in WebAssembly and this shared memory buffer. But this is a problem because the spec, WebAssembly ECMAScript integration spec doesn't say how to handle this, and we are not able to handle it because you can't export memory. You can't import memory from JavaScript modules, but WebAssembly has no way to declare a shared memory buffer, so it's kind of impossible to pass a shared memory buffer to a WebAssembly module. This may be some thinking is needed for the future to handle this kind of. It's currently anyway disabled because of a security reason. So, also there are other proposals for WebAssembly like reference type, so you can pass opaque JavaScript objects into the WebAssembly module and pass them around. There's proposal for garbage collection, so you can declare structured types in WebAssembly as they're handled with a browser garbage collection proposal, a garbage collector. So we may need to do something for this proposal when they merged. We may need to handle this kind of types on our boundaries because we are handling the boundaries. And there's also a proposal which is already merged for big integers in browsers. And it's kind of possible to use big int as a JavaScript representation for large integers. So if this would be a case, it's not the case because it's not in the spec yet, but if the spec would be changed to return big integers for eight byte integers, then we may need to change some of our implementation. Maybe it's more simple because we can remove all the handling for bigger or incompatible function signatures. And maybe we can think about if there's no code splitting construct for WebAssembly, you can use the JavaScript syntax to do code splitting and also to code split WebAssembly modules, but inside of a WebAssembly module, there's no such construct and it's not possible to write, compile a native language, code splitting construct in a native language to WebAssembly because there's no construct in WebAssembly or no section or no syntax for code splitting in WebAssembly. This may be needed, may not. We could look into this in the future. So, as last slide, my opinion on WebAssembly, I think currently the most use cases do some big WebAssembly blob compiled with a big native code fragments. And my hope is in the future there would be more the way of many small WebAssembly modules for doing some special thing or replacing single JavaScript modules, replacing them, or maybe for performance, maybe for other stuff, maybe for compiling native algorithms to integrating them into JavaScript. The reasons are similar to JavaScript. If you have many small modules, it's more modular. You can do code splitting. You can split part of application. You can do better tree shaking to detect what's used and what not. And I also thought that hiding the async nature of WebAssembly was a great decision because it makes it transparent if a module or a library uses WebAssembly or not because they're still synchronous. And if the library would be forced to use the WebAssembly API, it need to be asynchronous, use promises and all, change the API. So having transparent usage of WebAssembly in ECMAScript modules, I think it's great. And I also think that if the WebAssembly adoption increases and more native and bigger native languages are compiled to WebAssembly, code splitting stays important because big libraries tend to be slow at runtime for downloading, also for parsing and for execution. So it's still important to be able to code split parts or lazy load or on demand load parts of your application which contains bigger WebAssembly stuff. So thanks.
Tobias, thank you so much for your great talk. I keep getting constantly surprised by how much I don't know. So thank you so much. And as you all know, what we've got going on now is a discussion round with Tobias. So if you've got any questions, please lift your hand. And
so
I will...
not so much a discussion round.
I beg your pardon?
It's not a... discussion round. It's more of a Q&A. So yeah. Anything you wanted to hear. Well, we don't want anyone fighting back, to be honest. That's why I'm making it.
Yeah, it doesn't have to be for WebAssembly. It can be Webpack in general, if you have any questions or
yes.
Want to start a discussion with me.
So please just raise your hands if you have any questions or if you'd like to hear about something. And
so if you lift your hand, I will give you both the microphone and a treat.
I think that's our way of motivating you all
so for participation. So I see one question here.
I don't think it's a question. I think he wants the mic so he can hand it
just
out to people.
Just wants the chocolate.
Hi. So, well, first of all, thank you for the great talk. So how do you see WebAssembly shaping the future of the web development, like our day-to-day jobs?
Yeah, it's kind of unclear yet because I think WebAssembly is still missing some important pieces. There are many proposals, for example, for garbage collection. I think garbage collection is very important for bigger adoption of WebAssembly because currently the integration with native memory management, with kind of manual memory management, and the garbage collection memory management, automatic memory management in JavaScript, it's kind of two worlds together, and it's kind of difficult to use WebAssembly in an integrated modular way. So I hope if some more proposals in the future shaping WebAssembly in this direction to be easier usable, integrated, better integrated into JavaScript, I think the adoption will increase, and also with more bundlers maybe following the spec about integration WebAssembly, developer can technically replace smaller pieces of the code with WebAssembly modules. In example, Ember with Glimmer prepared kind of this, had a bytecode for this kind of VM and bytecode written in JavaScript for this kind of view layer, and they kind of be able to replace this VM with WebAssembly VM, and maybe it's faster, maybe it's smaller. So there are kind of ideas in the community to do something like this, but I think more libraries need to change, maybe the APL need to change, maybe newer libraries are prepared for WebAssembly. I think it's a long way to have big adoption. I think smaller steps are needed to make simple steps or small steps.
Thank you so much. So, is anyone else raising their hand? Feel free to ask about anything of Webpack, WebAssembly.
Anything
what his
about
favorite
JavaScript.
Animal is.
Oh, here we go.
We have a question on the end here.
Oh, thank you. Yes, thanks for your talk, and thanks for providing such a useful tool like Webpack. Like I'm using it since probably ages, and I'm super happy that it exists, because in the beginning when Bundler came out, there have been bundlers before, but you made them like importing CSS, importing images, and now even importing Rust and make it so seamless is a great thing. So here comes my question, is like what are the things that you're planning for Webpack in the future? Like, is there any special focus that you're currently working on? Like you did in the first thing, like pushing the web, like bundling everything. And also, what are you searching for? It's like, do you also searching for sponsors, for contributors to fund your work?
We always search for sponsors.
Okay.
Basically, Webpack 5 is work in progress, and the major new features will be. So we had this voting page about what you like for Webpack, what you like in general about Webpack, and the top most voted feature was persistent caching, so kind of improve the build performance on the startup from Webpack. So we basically implemented this, and we work in progress, but it can serialize all modules, all builded modules and past modules to the disk and restore it, and will improve build performance a lot at startup. So we're also working on improving the usability of long-term caching. So currently, long-term caching is a bit more complex to configure it correctly. So we're working on that to improve that and make it easier, and basically provide more easier to use features for this as alternative to the current. In example, we try to replace records, if you know what this is.
Thank you so much. So, is there anyone else? We still have time.
And we still have chocolate.
That's true. We have a whole box, so don't be shy. There's one in the back there, too.
Thanks. So, hi, my question is, did you hear about a Fastpack? And if you did, what do you think about it, like compared to Webpack? I know it's just a still small project, but I want to know your opinion about that.
Yeah, I heard about this. So basically, multiple competitors to Webpack, like Rollup, Parcel, or Fastpack. So I think they are most of these tools are created because a specific reason. Maybe they're focusing on some stuff. Rollup, for example, focused on code, on scope hoisting, Parcel on easy usability, and Fastpack on performance. So we kind of try to learn why these tools are created, or because of what reason these competitors are created, and try to improve on this area. So they're kind of showing us where we can improve, like better compression for ECMAScript modules for Rollup, or better usability for Parcel, or better performance for Fastpack. That, yeah, I already said that for Webpack 5, we're concentrating on improving the performance of the build. So kind of try to learn about from the competitors and what they do and why they are created to improve Webpack.
Okay, so do you think you can be fast Fastpack in the future, or do you think?
Because I don't think so, because Fastpack is very. Webpack has a very large feature set and have many features, and Fastpack is just created for performance and optimized for performance, and maybe lacks some features which decrease the performance but increase the user experience also. And Webpack is trying to focus on the best user experience, so not on. We don't care so much about build performance. We more care about better optimized bundles, better smaller bundles, better runtime performance. So we try to be faster, but I think it's not possible for us to reach the fastest possible build a bundler in the world.
Okay, thank you very much.
Oh, lots of questions popping up here. There's one at the front.
Okay. Do you have any plans to improve Webpack performance with WebAssembly, actually?
For what?
To use some WebAssembly modules in some critical parts, for example, building dependency graph or something.
You're asking if we want to use WebAssembly to improve the performance. Yeah, we actually did this. We tried this. We had a student for Google Summer of Code who and he tried, or he did actually implement the source code and the source map handling of Webpack, implemented this in WebAssembly, and it was faster. It was not so much faster that you would be surprised that it's super fast, but it's kind of 2x faster. But we can't you can use it if you, there's one line in the Webpack config you can add, and then you can use this as replacement of the Webpack integrated source handling. But the problem why we can't use it integrated in the Webpack as default, that is, again, the memory management, because the Webpack is written in Rust, or it doesn't care about what it's written, but it has a kind of manual memory management. So if you create some source, then you have to dispose the source again. But this is kind of not usable in the Webpack workflow, because before it was everything is garbage collected, handled by default. We pass sources around, don't know when they're no longer used. They're also put in cached and used later. So this is kind of the problematic currently, that we don't know when to dispose all the memory. We could not dispose it, but it would leak memory, and that would be not nice.
Could it be solved with shared ref buffers later?
With shared buffers?
Yeah.
Yes, they're using a shared or a memory buffer, but the current idea of this package is to just dispose everything at the end of the build, but this kind of only works for a single build, because some sources are put into cache and used later. So the idea is there, but I think WebAssembly lacks some features like garbage collection to use it to integrate very well with JavaScript. If it has garbage collection and these sources would automatically garbage collected, then we could just use it to place it, and everything would have the same API like before. Now the API has changed to add a dispose method, which is very difficult to use when manual memory management is difficult. So yes, we tried it. It works for performance, but it has some challenges, which are with integration with JavaScript.
Yeah, cool. Thanks.
So if anyone has any more pressing questions, I think they can come find you tomorrow.
Yeah, you're sure. Still with
Thank you so much for answering our questions and for that incredible talk. If you could all give him another round.